All matter can pretty much be broken down into two types, either a mixture or a pure substance. And pure substances can exist either as elements or as compounds. Elements, of course, are defined as all the atoms within that sample having the same number of protons. And that would be considered an element. And we've seen that the elements are arranged on the periodic table. Compounds, on the other hand, are composed of more than one type of element. And so here we have an element. Oh, let's just say it's nitrogen gas, where we have two atoms, but they're the same type of atom. So that's the elemental form of nitrogen. And here's an element that exists as a single atom at room temperature and pressure, let's say helium. Whereas the compound in these types of space-filling models, different colors are indicating that you have different types of atoms. And in this case, we could say that that's carbon, and this is oxygen, and this is oxygen. Excuse me, this is oxygen, and these are hydrogen. So you can see that they're combinations of different types of atoms of different elements to give compounds. Now, the elements, of course, cannot be broken down into simpler substances by physical or chemical means. By physical or chemical means. And as it turns out, most of the known elements are metals, and they exist at room temperature and pressure as solids. Here's just some examples. Molecular oxygen, molecular nitrogen, and the helium atom. Just some examples of some elements. These, of course, all exist as gas at room temperature and pressure, whereas on the periodic table, the majority are metals. They exist as solids. We model them typically as single atoms of the same type existing in some sort of a crystalline array associated with the solid. Okay? But they're all the same type of atom, same number of protons. Now, for compounds, although they're made of different atoms of different elements, they do have a fixed composition. That means if it is a particular type of pure substance that we call, a compound of, let's say, water, you're always going to have one oxygen in a ratio to two hydrogen atoms for every water, no matter where you sample it from. That's what we mean by fixed composition. But these compounds are capable of being broken down into elements or simpler substances, simpler compounds, by chemical means. Simpler compounds, depending on the element, of course, excuse me, depending on the compound or compounds by chemical means. The elemental composition indicates the type of compound that you have. And the elemental composition can be inferred from the name. So it's very important to be able to identify names of compounds and to be able to hear a name of a compound and have a visual of image of what that compound is. Now, the position on the periodic table tells us about the chemical and physical properties of the elements. We've seen that. But also, the type of compound and the component elements tells us something about the chemical and physical properties of the compounds. So we need to be familiar with the elements, and we need to be familiar with some common types of compounds. And from that familiarity, you can then predict the types of chemical and physical and chemical properties of those compounds. Now, the type of compound, which is so important to be able to predict, is defined by the type of bonding that occurs between the atoms within the compound. All right, so if we look at the periodic table at a glance, we know that we have metals on the left-hand side and we have non-metals on the right-hand side. And just from that idea, we have an image of the types of properties the metals will have versus the non-metals. So if you can find cadmium on the periodic table, you can immediately see that it's a metal and you can start to predict the types of properties that it would have. Now, for compounds, there's three types of compounds that you need to be familiar with. And once you're familiar with them, you can start to get to know these compounds a little bit better and be able to predict their chemical and physical properties. The first type are ionic compounds, and they're formed by the strong attraction between oppositely charged species, typically between a metal cation and a non-metal anion. However, we will also need to become familiar with the polyatomic ions and be able to identify those. But the simplest case, first of all, is just a metal cation and a non-metal anion. And so whenever you see a compound, let's say calcium oxide, immediately you would go back to the periodic table, find where's calcium, find where is oxygen, identify them as a metal and a nonmetal, and be able to predict that type of compound is an ionic compound. For the covalent compounds, also referred to as molecules, they're formed by the strong attraction of different nuclei for the same pair of electrons. We call that a shared pair of electrons. Typically, this type of bonding occurs between nonmetals and other nonmetals sharing electrons. So again, if you were to see that there's a compound carbon monoxide, CO, you could look back at the periodic table and know that carbon is a nonmetal and oxygen is a nonmetal, and be able to predict right away that that is going to be a covalent compound. Finally, metallic compounds are formed by the strong attraction of different nuclei for the sea of electrons, the same sea of electrons in which they reside. This attractive force is between the metals and the metals, all sharing the same electrons. This type of situation exists, for example, if you see a chunk of silver, pure silver. You see that it's a solid, you know that the individual silver atoms have to be bound to one another in some way, shape, or form, and they are bound by something called a metallic bond. So we have ionic compounds, covalent compounds, and metallic compounds, or metallic elements. In this case, we are understanding the properties, chemical and physical, of the compounds based on the type of bonding that exists in that particular compound.